Jeremy, are you set?
I know.
Good morning. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Just a few announcements. First of all, wine study and Bible tasting is today at 4 o'clock at our house. We're going to watch the movie God and Country. So if you want to bring something to share, to eat, we'll have something. I don't know what. I gotta go home today yet and cook. But you'll be fed. And there will always be something good to drink. If you don't drink wine, don't worry. There's other things. And there's always water. Or you can always just bring something yourself. But you're all welcome to come. The Rally Day Sunday is September 8th. And after church, we're having a potluck. If you haven't guessed yet, it's a Western theme. So bring and wear your best Western gear. Go on up to Boot Barn. No, I don't get paid for advertising for them. There's always Kleinschmidt's over in Springfield, etc. But go get some Western gear. I'm making myself a note to wear those wonderful cowboy boots that I've got from Texas that I've never worn here in Missouri. So, but come, have fun. CE is getting fried chicken. So there's a sign-up sheet out there to sign up for other things that you'd like to bring. It's a potluck, but CE is providing chicken. If you have questions, Dale, raise your hand. Say hi to the folks. Say howdy. See Dale if you have questions. Church council is today after church downstairs. If you're on council, we expect you to be there. Right, Sonia? She's nodding her head. One other thing. Starting next Sunday, I'm going to be on vacation. Once again, I'm going to be in a remote area that has very little cell service, very little contact. If you have an emergency, contact Sonia. She will have the bat signal to be able to get in touch with me in a real emergency. Y'all know who Sonia is, your intrepid council president. So if you have an emergency, contact Sonia. Texts, emails, etc. will not be returned from me until I return from vacation. If it's something that can wait, go ahead, send it. But just know, it will be returned when I return from vacation. So, the last thing. A little birdie today told me that it's a very special birthday today for someone. Liz is 30 years old today. Times three, if I might ask Chad. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Liz. Happy birthday to you. Wonderful. Let us begin.
I have one of those yummy cakes in the back, so don't leave without a big piece of nice gooey cake.
Your servant Moses, righteousness be. trumpet call. Lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. And out of Zion till salvation comes. There is no God like Jehovah. 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 Sun at the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. Lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes.
Would you stand as you are able, please, and join me in our call to worship responsively. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth, into joyous song, and sing praises. Sing praises to the Lord with the lyre and the sound of melody, with trumpets and the sound of the horn. Joyful noise before the King, the Lord. Let the sea roar and all that fills it, the world and those who live in it. Let the floods clap their hands. Let the hills sing together for joy at the presence of the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with equity. And join me now in our prayer of invocation. Creator God, who saved Daniel from the lion's den, save us from the dangers that surround us, the danger of pride, the danger of greed, the danger of scorn. Fill our hearts with love and compassion for others, knowing that there will never be a face we look upon that is not loved by you. Grant us strength and courage as we walk through the den of despair, to be the one in spirit, one in love, one in you. Amen. And now take your hymnals, please, and join us in our opening hymn, number 554, You Are My Hiding Place. Seated. Would the young adults like to come up? Okay. So we talk a lot in church about how God sees all of us the same. We talk a lot about equity. Do you think, when you look at just our community, we won't even look at the whole wide world, let's just look at our community of Kansas City. Do you think everybody has the same opportunities? Do you think all the schools are exactly the same? Some schools are better, right? Because they're in more affluent areas, and since all of our taxes that pay for schools are based on property taxes, then obviously if a school is in a neighborhood that's got bigger, fancier, more expensive houses, they're going to have more money. They probably pay their teachers more. That doesn't make teachers who work at a school that doesn't get paid as much a worse teacher, but they might be struggling more. So I wonder, do you think the education is the same then? Yeah, probably not. They might have, as we graduate, we say we have tools for our lives to come, whether we go to college or trade school or just into a job or whatever, we have tools for that stuff, right? So if we were to take those, we would say probably the one who lives in the most affluent area gets the best education, the best opportunities, maybe opportunities to go to college, whereas kids whose parents don't have that kind of money and struggle, don't get to go to college, etc., they probably get the best tool, right? Who wants the best tool? All right. So kids who go to good enough schools, shall we say, and you know, and maybe their parents work hard and might have a little bit of money to be able to help them somewhat with college or trade school or whatever, so they have the next best tool. They're going to do great. The other one has the least. Now, when they get out into the world, they have then the same task that everybody else has. Now, in this case, I'm going to give you a task. These are chocolate-covered sunflower seeds. And your task is to, these are, say, the benefits of society, of jobs, of opportunities, of things out there. And your task, then, is to scoop up as many as you can for yourself. Go for it. That's all right. We'll clean it up later. We'll hire church mice. All right. They're determined. They're going to get every last one, so. I'm going to play government subsidy program. Okay. Yeah. All right. Hold up your cups. How many? Who got the most? Show them. So the one who had the best tools got the very most. The one who had the next best, she did okay. She got some. And, well, okay. We discovered that that little tool that she got was not so very great in scooping up all of the opportunities in the world. So guys, I'm not good with these things. How can we make our world more equitable? How can we make sure that poor Eleanor gets all the opportunities that her sister Clara got? How can we do that? Sharing. So in other words, if Clara might have shared her spoon with her sister. Well, guys, your reward for going through this morning is what you scooped out. And since you're since your sisters, maybe your sister will be kind and share with you. But yeah, let's think about how we can make our world more equitable, shall we? Let's say a prayer. Lord, help us to make things more equitable. Help us to understand that we think we all have the same opportunities, but maybe we don't. Help us to see our world through your eyes and take your actions. Amen. Thanks, guys. Enjoy the candies. Get your sister to share.
Thank you. Our scripture for today is from Daniel chapter 6, verses 6 through 27. So the administrators and satraps conspired and came to the king and said to him, O King Darius, live forever. All the administrators of the kingdom, the prefects and the satraps, the counselors and the governors are agreed that the king should establish an ordinance and enforce an interdict that whoever prays to any god or human for 30 days, except to you, O king, shall be thrown into the den of lions. Now, O king, establish the interdict and sign the document so that it cannot be changed according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which cannot be revoked. Therefore, King Darius signed the document and interdict. Although Daniel knew that the document had been signed, he continued to go to his house, which had windows in its upper room open toward Jerusalem, and to get down on his knees three times a day to pray to his God and praise him, just as he had done previously. Then those men watched and found Daniel praying and seeking mercy before his God. Then they approached the king and said concerning the interdict, O king, did you not sign an interdict that anyone who prays to any god or human within 30 days, except to you, O king, shall be thrown into the den of lions? The king answered, The thing stands fast according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which cannot be revoked. Then they responded to the king, Daniel, one of the exiles from Judah, pays no attention to you, O king, or to the interdict you have signed, but he is saying his prayers three times a day. When the king heard the charge, he was very much distressed. He was determined to save Daniel, and until the sun went down, he made every effort to rescue him. Then the conspirators came to the king and said to him, Know, O king, that it is a law of the Medes and Persians that no interdict or ordinance that the king establishes can be changed. Then the king gave the command, and Daniel was brought and thrown into the den of lions. The king said to Daniel, May your God, whom you faithfully serve, deliver you. A stone was brought and laid on the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet ring and with the signet ring of his lords, so that nothing might be changed concerning Daniel. Then the king went to his palace and spent the night fasting. No entertainment was brought to him, and sleep fled from him. Then at dawn the king got up, and at first light hurried to the den of lions. When he came near the den where Daniel was, he cried out anxiously to Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you faithfully serve, been able to deliver you from the lions? Daniel then said to the king, O king, live forever. My God sent his angels and shut the lions' mouths so that they would not hurt me, because I was found blameless before him and before you, O king. I have done no wrong. Then the king was exceedingly glad and commanded that Daniel be taken up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no kind of harm was found on him, because he had trusted in his God. The king gave a command, and those who had maliciously accused Daniel were brought and thrown into the den of lions. They, their children, and their wives, before they reached the bottom of the den, the lions overpowered them and broke all their bones in pieces. Then King Darius wrote to all peoples and nations of every language throughout the whole world. May you have abundant prosperity. I make a decree that in all my royal dominion, people shall tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. For he is the living God, enduring forever. His kingdom shall never be destroyed, and his dominion has no end. He delivers and rescues. He works signs and wonders in heaven and on earth. He has saved Daniel from the power of the lions. This ends the reading of our scripture for today.
May the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable to you, our Lord, our Rock, our Redeemer, and Sustainer. Amen. Last week, then King Nebuchadnezzar declared that no one could speak against the God of the exiled Israelites. Note that this week, the Israelites are still exiled in Babylon, but there's a different ruler, Darius. King Darius is actually the third king for Daniel to serve. See that prophecy that we talked about in the king's dream? It's coming true. Now, the four companions we have been reading about have continued to earn favor with all of the kings. Because they are honest, because they are upright individuals of integrity. The Babylonians, meanwhile, have forgotten that it was Daniel himself who saved all of the Babylonian wise men and advisors from being slaughtered by King Nebuchadnezzar. Instead, they're still nursing their petty jealousies. Daniel is one of three men chosen by King Darius to be overseers of all of the Babylonian administrators. Again, Daniel was chosen because of his honesty and his integrity, qualities the Babylonian administrators are not exhibiting. Now, rather than decide to clean up their own act, these Babylonians, they conspire once again to get rid of these pesky foreigners who are taking all of their posh jobs. They set about to manipulate this new king. First, they tell the king that everyone agrees that the king should enact a new law that anyone who prays for 30 days to anyone other than the king should die. They stroke his ego. And they use this anonymous, everyone is saying, to make the king believe that, well, this must be the prevailing opinion of everyone. And then they trap him into issuing a law that he cannot change. Oh, what tangled webs we weave. When Daniel emerges unharmed from the lion's den, he reminds the king that not only had he done nothing wrong in God's eyes, but he had done nothing wrong in the king's eyes. And the king acknowledged that. And he then took action against those who had tried and actually succeeded in manipulating him. This is an extreme story. The Bible is full of extreme stories. Think of all of the parables as examples. These stories were all told in the hopes that humans would recognize themselves and their own actions, their own behaviors, and then repent. But I wonder, do we humans actually do that? Or do we deflect? Do we make up lame excuses? Or do we search for ways to manipulate other people in order to get what we want? And when we don't get our own way, do we even recognize how low we will stoop to malign other people? Casting aside all of the times those same individuals were there for us, made sacrifices for us, or simply went about their own lives without interfering in ours. God's commandments are all about not harming others. Do we follow them? We think we do. If we don't murder or steal or commit adultery. But things get a little stickier in some of them. Like when we get to Exodus 20:16, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You know, in our contemporary world, we think that's all about court proceedings. Not so. It's all about community. It's all about how we talk about and behave with others. Anyone who participates in gossip and/or manipulation breaks that commandment. The definition of gospel, definition of gospel is very, very clear. Love God, love your neighbor. Okay, but the definition of gossip, on the other hand, is also simple. Anytime a person is talking about someone else, and that person is not present, they're indulging in gossip. The only purpose of gossip is to demonize another person. Gossip is always about telling only one side of the story, and usually not the clear, total story. Gossip always leaves out or minimizes the teller's culpability in what they're talking about. Well, when we do this, we are exactly like those Babylonians who somehow thought they could elevate their status with the king by harming Daniel. Hear this well. No one has ever earned their angel wings by painting devil's horns on somebody else. I'll say it again. No one has ever earned their angel wings by painting devil's horns on someone else. If you're telling someone about what another person said or did, you are participating in gossip. If you are listening to someone else talk about what another person said or did, you are participating in gossip. People get upset when they hear that. They try to defend themselves. They say, well, if a friend comes to them upset over what someone else said or did, well, they're going to listen because they care about their friend. That you are a caring individual is exactly why that so-called friend targeted you to manipulate you. Such tales of woe are frequently embellished or key pieces left out. And the injured party conveying the story will always leave out the part about how what they did triggered their reaction in the person that they now feel offended by. Listening to gossip is detrimental to the hearer, because once you hear something, it cannot be unheard. Now, you may say you can discern for yourself what to believe or not to believe, but in truth, your opinions about the non-present target of that gossip are now overshadowed. You will subconsciously or even consciously start to look for reasons to dislike or even demonize that person. Start thinking of television commercials that you're seeing over elections. Consider this. If a powerful king like Darius can be so easily manipulated, I think few of us stand a chance. Truly. Gossip and manipulation quickly destroy covenant and community. And no one is immune. In fact, as we can see from the story about Daniel, the more honesty and integrity a person has, the more malicious the gossipers will be. I'll give you an example. I knew of a pastor who once discovered members of his council were involved in a huge tax evasion scheme involving the church. And when he confronted those people, the guilty parties started a rumor about sexual improprieties about the pastor. Unfounded, untrue. But again, once the gossip is heard, it plants suspicion and doubt and distrust. That pastor's career was destroyed. How many of you have ever been the target of gossip? How many of you have ever lost friendships or jobs or even just sleep over gossip? I know I have. How do we guard ourselves against gossip and manipulation? From friends, fellow church members, politicians, the media? Well, first, when someone begins to tell you something about someone else, stop them. Tell them right off you won't participate in gossip. Or, as a therapist once suggested, say to them, "I wonder how so-and-so will feel when I tell them you told me this." She's vicious. Next, take a good, hard, honest look at ourselves, all of us, what we say and what we do. Do we keep a running score about all the things that people say or do that bother us, yet ignore or forget or downplay all of the good, kind things they do? 2 years ago, when I accepted the call to be your pastor here at Bethel, I asked the search committee a question that sort of puzzle them. I'm going to ask you the same question. Those on the search committee don't get to answer. You walk into church one morning and you see sitting on one of the pews some empty candy wrappers. What do you do? How do you react? Pick them up, throw them away. Anything else? I love that answer. She said, "Why didn't they share with me?" circumstances. I'm going to look for more candy. This is why I love you guys. This is why you're the unicorn church. Because this is something that I actually witnessed at another church. And you know what? I saw members walk in, see them, run and get the janitor, drag him into the church, show them to him, lambaste him for not doing a good job, and then complain constantly about what a bad, horrible job he did at cleaning the church. Forgetting all the times that he went to their houses and moved furniture for them, did odd jobs, maintenance things, at their own homes out of the goodness of his heart. See, I can fall into that. I get grumpy. I get... I do. I'm human. Having a collar means nothing. I'm human. See, I have to take the advice from Lori DeShane, who said, practice the pause. Pause before judging. Pause before assuming. Pause before accusing. Pause whenever you're about to react harshly. So what does that look like? It looks like, for me, not just tossing out the half-full coffee cup I found left sitting in the church, but going a step further and being thankful that whoever left it was here participating in the life of the church. It means, instead of walking in and to the office and grumbling that there was no toner in the copier this week, expressing thanks to the person who printed out 2 weeks of bulletins at home on her own printer while she's waiting for supplies to come in to get our printer working. It means pulling weeds. When I come in and I see some weeds in the garden, instead of complaining that there's weeds in the garden, and being thankful that we have volunteers who come here in 90 plus degree sun and mow our lawns and pull weeds and rip up old timbers and chop down tree thingies. It means turning the communion table around if it somehow got put back backwards, and expressing thanks that someone vacuumed out from under our altar. It means when I notice myself in a parable or in a sermon in church, I decide to do better. And not just get mad and storm out of church. In fact, I'll tell you how one of those situations changed my life. It was, life was just getting me so down. Everybody hated me. It was so hard. And God doesn't listen. And the pastor gave a sermon asking, do you get mad that God doesn't give you everything you want? Or do you express thanks that God is giving you everything you need? 2 years later, I went to seminary. If we adjust our own eyes and our own attitudes and look for and find the good that people do, we take a major step in combating the gossip and the manipulation that can wreck a community. When we commit to not just accepting people, but celebrating each and every one for who they are, the way they are, and everything they do for the community, we start to repair the damage that gossip does. You want to know the very best way not to fall victim to manipulative gossip the way King Darius did? I'll tell you the best way. Make it a practice that whenever someone brings up another person's name to you, immediately interrupt them with a story of how that person has helped you, or has been kind to you, or how much that person has done for others. Immediately interrupt them and tell them how much you love that person they were going to talk about. It will probably stop them. It might actually change their minds. What it absolutely will do is foster a more loving, positive community for everyone here. Darius had choices to make. He chose to let himself be manipulated, which was nearly fatal for Daniel, an honest man of integrity. All of us here at Bethel and in our wider community of Kansas City and beyond have choices to make. Choose love. Choose inclusion. Choose empathy. Choose compassion. Choose equality. Choose integrity. Choose kindness. Choose facts. Choose peace. Choose honesty. Choose respect. Choose community. Choose to follow Jesus. Please, choose love. Amen. May we stand as we are able and sing together hymn number 622, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. Thank you. Please be seated. We come now in the time of our service when we, the people of God, reach out to our God, knowing that God is not some old man with a long gray beard on a cloud with a whiteboard. But God is right here with us, among us, within us, loving every last hair on every last head, and those who don't have hair on their heads, loving every fiber of their being. We ask, God, that you continue to bless Jerry, who's been ill and in the hospital and is still not feeling well. Lord, you've brought her through so many storms. Could you calm the sea and bring her health? We thank you and we celebrate Alice's recovery and her completion of chemotherapy. And we thank you. We thank you so much for healing our Dorcas. We thank you so much for Liz celebrating her 90th birthday and all of us who are celebrating getting older. We thank you for getting older. And help us when we complain about getting older. We thank you for this community. Perfectly imperfect and imperfectly perfect as we are, we thank you for the love. Let the love rule and reign. Help us when we grumble. And help us to celebrate joy every single minute. And celebrate each other. The way Jesus taught us. As he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. All good gifts come from you, O God. And of the gifts you have given us, we return to you asking that you use these gifts and use us, body, mind, and spirit, to further your love in this world. Amen. Okay, we can't have Daniel and the lions without some kind of fun. You all know this song. Nobody can say they don't. We're going to have some fun. We've got the contemporary folks up here to lead us because, well, it's not our usual hymn. And the words have been slightly changed in the bulletin. And I told Jeremy, I know that people are going to be swearing at me come Tuesday, because this is going to be the earworm that's still stuck in your head. And I'm okay with that.
We home on the way. Wingo up a 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 wingo up. In the lies and the dangerous lines, and the lion sleeps good night.
Fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature, O Thou of God and man of spring,
Thee will I cherish, You will I honor, O my soul's glory, joy, and crown.